Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Case of the Bizarre Bouquets, an Enola Holmes mystery by Nancy Springer, narrated by Katherine Kellgren, and directed by Dave Millen.
March 1889. Lunatics have no common sense, thinks the matron. But then, that's what deranges the faculties, isn't it? Lack of common sense. Take this new inmate now. If he had any sense, he would be exercising with the others in the airing yard on this beautiful sunny day, the first fine day of spring. He'd be following directions. Stand up straight, breathe deeply, lift your eyes and contemplate the glories of the firmament. Now march, left foot first. 1, 2, 3, 4. And he'd be doing himself some good. But instead, let me out, he demands for perhaps the 100th time. I am an Englishman. Such treatment of a British citizen simply cannot be tolerated. While his tone is angry, he doesn't curse. She'll give him that. Even at his worst, when he fought with the keepers, when he blackened the director's eye, even then he hadn't cursed. Nor does he now, only complaining vehemently, let me out! I demand my rights as a loyal subject of the Queen! Let me out of this confounded coffin, I say! It's not a coffin, Mr. Kippersault. Sitting in a comfortless wooden chair, cushioned only by her own amplitude while in her lap she knits a sock, the matron speaks in a bored but soothing tone. The top and bottom resemble those of a coffin, perhaps, but you know quite well that a coffin would not have spindle work all up and down the sides so you can breathe and I can see that you are not in any difficulties.
Not in any difficulties?
Unexpectedly, the man lying in the confines of the restraining box starts to laugh. At the sound of his laughter, the matron drops a stitch, frowns, and lays her knitting aside, reaching for paper and pencil instead.
Not in any difficulties in this fiendish device,
the man cries amid unnaturally high-pitched yowls of laughter.
You do not appear to be physically indisposed, answers the matron with gentle dignity. And you are lying on a clean pallet, and you can change your position, move your hands. Certainly the crib is preferable to a straitjacket.
A crib? Is that what it's called?
The man is still laughing for no good reason. The matron watches him narrowly, knowing she must take care with him. He was quite unexpectedly quick for such a stocky fellow, and resourceful, too. He very nearly made it to the fence. In Mr. Kippersault's barely started casebook, she writes the date and time. Then, patient laughing in apparent hysteria. Earlier notations state that Mr. Kippersault most strenuously resisted putting on his grey woolen uniform while his own things were taken away for safekeeping, that he has refused food, that his urine is light and clear, he moves his bowels appropriately, and he seems to be of a cleanly nature, that he shows no deformity of head, trunk, or limbs, that he exhibits intelligence of a sort, and that he uses a handkerchief.
A crib! As in cheating me of my freedom.
The man's unnerving laughter is quieting. Not a bad-looking man of middle age, a soldierly type. He strokes his moustache with his fingers as if to calm himself or to think.
When are you going to let me out?
After the doctor has looked you over.
After first administering chloral hydrate, the matron feels sure. Himself an addict to laudanum and the like, the asylum's doctor troubles himself little with the inmates other than to medicate them.
Doctor? I am a doctor!
The newly committed lunatic starts once again to howl with laughter. The matron writes,
persists in his grandiose delusions.
Setting the casebook aside, she takes up her knitting again. Trying to turn the heel of a sock can be most vexing, but that's the way things are when one is married to the director of a lunatic asylum. Always seven things to do at once, never a quiet moment to simply rest one's soul, go for a walk, or look at a newspaper. The nurses require as much supervision as the patients do. Florence Nightingale's influence has not extended here, and the help is illiterate at best, if not in the grip of some vice, usually drink. The matron sighs. Trying to pick up the stitch she dropped, she cannot keep a slight edge from creeping into her voice as she replies, "A doctor? That's not true, Mr. Kippersault. Your documents of admission clearly state that you are a shopkeeper." "My name is not Kippersault. I am not the person you say I am. Why can I not make anyone in this hellish place understand that I am here because of some absurd misapprehension?" Feeling the man watching her from the coffin-like box in which he lies, the matron smiles, albeit wearily. "In my experience of the past 30 years, Mr. Kippersault, patients very often believe a mistake has been made, but it has never been so." How could it be, when such considerable sums of money have changed hands? "Take a gentleman like you now. A number have come here declaring themselves to be Napoleon. That's the most frequent. But we've had a Prince Albert, a Sir Francis Drake, and a William Shakespeare."
"I'm telling you the truth!"
"And some of those poor distracted minds are eventually cured," the matron speaks on, ignoring the interruption, "but some of them remain here yet. Is that what you want, Mr. Kippersault, to remain here for the rest of your life?"
"My name is not Kippersault, it's Watson!"
Even through the spindle, she can see his moustache bristling. With kindly whimsy, she retorts, "We have a Sherlock Holmes in one of the other wards. I wonder whether he would care to vouch for you."
"You are mad. I tell you, I am John Watson, medical doctor and author. All you have to do is telephone Scotland Yard."
Telephone. As if anyone this far north of London City has ever seen or used such a come-lately contraption. Just call Scotland Yard. Grandiose delusions again.
"And ask for Inspector Lestrade. He will confirm my identity."
"Nonsense," the matron murmurs. "Nonsense." He really thinks the director will make inquiries, give back a considerable fee, and turn him loose. The man is raving. "Shush now, shush." As if trying to calm a child, she murmurs to him, concerned. Such passion might lead to brain fever if it does not soon abate. It has been 2 days now, and Mr. Kippersault is still ranting just as irrationally as he was when they brought him in. A sad case, really. The matron has dealt with many lunatics, but she feels particularly sorry for this one, because he seems as if he might have so much good in him if he were in his right mind. Chapter the First. It is difficult to choose a new name for oneself. Even more difficult, I imagine, than choosing a name for a child, for one is confusingly intimate with oneself, whereas one is barely acquainted with a baby upon its arrival. Some artistic whim, surely, had caused Mum to name me Enola, which backwards spells alone. Do not think about Mum. Although the large bruise on my face had faded, the even larger one upon my feelings had not. Thus I remained in my lodging on the first fine sunny day in March 1889. With paper and pencil in hand, I sat at my open window. How welcome is fresh air, even the London variety after a long winter, looking out over the seething East End street. The scene below had attracted my attention. Due to a quantity of mutton still on the hoof passing through, all manner of vehicles, including coal wagons, donkey carts, and costermongers' barrows, had locked shafts. I could hear the drivers shouting the most frightful oaths at one another. Red-coated army recruiters and other idlers looked on, grinning, while a blind beggar led by a ragged child tried to get past the jam. Street urchins climbed lampposts to stare and jeer, and women in sooty shawls hurried on their errands. They, the sorely overworked women of the slums, unlike me, had somewhere to go. Looking down on the paper in my lap, I found that I had written Enola Holmes. Hastily and heavily, I crossed out this, my very own name, the one I absolutely could not use. My brothers Mycroft and Sherlock, you see, must not find me, for they quite wanted to take charge of me and transform me, via singing lessons and similar vapours, into an ornament for genteel society, which legally they could do. Force me into boarding school, I mean, or into a convent, an orphanage, a young ladies' academy of porcelain painting, whatever they chose. Legally, Mycroft, the elder, could have me locked up for life in an insane asylum. Such confinement required only the signature of two medical doctors, one of whom would be the mad doctor, who quite wanted money to run the place. Those, and the signature of Mycroft himself, any scheme to deprive me of my freedom, I would not put beyond him. I wrote Ivy Meshel, the name I had used during the 6 months I had been a fugitive on my own. Ivy, for fidelity, Meshel, a play on Holmes. Whole mess. Mess, whole, Meshel. And I liked that name. I really wished I could keep it. But I was afraid. I had discovered that Sherlock knew I used Ivy as a code name when communicating with Mum through the newspaper personal columns. What else did my oh-so-clever brother Sherlock, the one who, as opposed to the large and Cecil Mycroft, was actually on the hunt for me, what did Sherlock know about me? What had he learned in the course of our most irregular dealings? I wrote, he knows I look like him. He knows I climb trees. He knows I ride a bicycle. He knows I disguised myself as a widow. He knows I disguised myself as a poor woman selling pen wipers. He knows I disguised myself as a nun. He knows I gave food and blankets to the poor. He knows I carry a dagger in my corset. He knows I have located two missing persons. He knows I have put the police onto two villains. He knows I have twice invaded his Baker Street rooms. He knows I use the name Ivy. One must assume that he knows from Dr. Watson that a young woman named Ivy Meshel worked for the world's first and only scientific purgatorian. I sighed at this last, for I quite admired Dr. Watson, although I had encountered the good physician only 3 times. The first when he had come to consult the purgatorian, a professional seeker of missing persons, for the sake of his friend Sherlock Holmes. The second, when I had gone to ask him a question and he had given me a bromide for a headache. The third, when I had thrust an injured lady upon his care. Dr. Watson was the epitome of a gallant, sturdy English gentleman willing to help anyone. I liked him tremendously, almost as much as I liked my brother, for, despite everything, I did adore Sherlock, although I knew him mainly through the very popular stories his friend Watson wrote about him, which I read as avidly as anyone in England. Why? Why did those for whom I cared always seem to prove my undoing? Sighing, I pressed my lips together and drew several heavy pencil lines, crossing out Ivy Meshel. What, then? It was not just choosing a new name that baffled me. It was the all-encompassing problem of what to do and whom to be. Within what sort of woman should I next hide myself? A commoner Mary or Susan? How dull. Yet the flower names I loved, such as Rosemary, symbol of remembrance, or Violet, symbol of hidden beauty and virtue, were out of the question, for Sherlock knew about the code Mother and I used. Nor could I fall back upon one of my middle names. I had, of course, the usual gentrified quota of them, being christened Enola Eudoria Hadassah Holmes. Enola E. H. Holmes. E. E. H. H. Eh. Just the way I felt.
Hadassah being my father's deceased sister's name, which Sherlock would instantly recognize, and Eudoria, even worse, being my mother's given name. Not that I cared in any way to style myself after my mother. Or did I?
Curses ye gods,
I muttered naughtily, writing down Violet Vernette. Vernette being my mother's maiden name, which, again, Sherlock Holmes would recognize at once. But perhaps backwards?
Tenrev.
Well, no, but if I played with the letters a bit. Netver. Never. Every. Ever. Ever what? Ever alone? Ever forlorn?
Ever defiant, I told myself sternly. Ever to go on being what I am. A rebel, a dreamer, and a purgatorian, finder of the lost.
It occurred to me that as a step in that direction, in order to hear news that did not reach print, I ought to try to find a position with some Fleet Street publication. Coincidentally, as I thought this, I heard my landlady's tortoise-like tread upon the stairs.
"Newspapers, Miss Meshel!"
she bellowed even before she had reached the landing. Being as deaf as a turnip, Mrs. Tupper seemed to find it necessary to make a great deal of noise. As I stood up, crossed my room, and threw everything I had written into the fire, she knocked hard enough to crack walnuts.
"Newspapers, Miss Meshel!"
she shouted into my face just as I opened the door.
"Thank you, Mrs. Tupper!"
She couldn't hear me, of course, but she could see my lips move in what I hoped was a smile as I took the papers from her hands. However, she did not then go away. Instead, she straightened her short, hunched form to its limit and fixed me with her watery gaze.
"Miss Meshel,"
she declaimed with the bravado of one who has decided to perform a moral duty,
"it's no good you're shutting yourself up this way. Now, whatever happened, and it's none of my business, but whatever it was, it's no use getting pale about. Now, it's a nice day out with a bit of sun and starting to feel springish. Now, why don't you get your bonnet on and go for a walk at least?"
Or I believe she said something of the sort. I barely heard her, and I am sorry to say I shut the door in her face, for my gaze had caught upon the Daily Telegraph's headline and fixed there. It said, "Sherlock Holmes associate mysteriously disappears. Dr. Watson's whereabouts unknown." Chapter the Second. Not pausing even to take a seat, but standing where I was with the skirt of my cheap cotton at-home dress nearly in the fire, I read, "Events sure to send a frisson of horror through any spine with delicacy of feeling have unfolded in Bloomsbury, with implications taking in the whole of London if a missing British gentleman is not soon found. Dr. John Watson, a respected physician, perhaps best known as companion of and chronicler of the adventures of the famous detective Mr. Sherlock Holmes, has most mystifyingly disappeared without a trace. Foremost among the thoughts of the absent man's family and friends, of course, is terror lest he might have fallen into the hands of some criminal enemy of Mr. Sherlock Holmes to be used as a pawn in some nefarious scheme, bandied as a hostage, or dispatched for the sake of revenge. Alternately, concern has been expressed that carrying his black bag identifying him as a physician, he might have been attacked by an anti-vaccination mob in the East End. No form of foul play at this time may be ruled out. Attempts are being made to trace Dr. Watson's movements this Tuesday last, on which day he departed to perform customary calls and errands, but failed to return to his home and business in the evening. Cab drivers are being questioned, and so forth. A great many words to describe, essentially nothing. An absence not newsworthy at all if it were not that my brother's name could be deployed in the headline. Dr. Watson had kissed his wife goodbye on Wednesday morning. This was Friday afternoon. The good doctor had been gone for 2 days. I imagined the police were saying, with some justification, that any number of harmless events may have caused the doctor's absence, and at any moment a telegram or letter should arrive explaining where and why he had been detained. Attempts are being made meant that the police were not yet investigating, otherwise the newspaper would have named the inspector in charge. No, at this point the only people really trying to locate Dr. Watson were two, his wife and his friend, my brother, Sherlock Holmes. And now one more. Me. But wait. What if Watson's absence had been arranged by my brother as a scheme to entrap me? Sherlock knew that I'd embroiled myself in two cases of missing persons, and while he might not understand that I'd invented Dr. Leslie Rogostin, scientific purgatorian, quite possibly he knew I had worked for the man. Did he appreciate that this was my life's calling, to be a finder of the lost? Did he guess how very fond I was of the fatherly Dr. Watson? Should I not, then, regard recent developments with the utmost suspicion? But even as these eminently sensible considerations traversed my mind, already I was throwing the newspaper on the fire, then rummaging in my wardrobe, considering possible ways to disguise myself, possible strategies to find out the details of Dr. Watson's disappearance, how best to approach the matter. Indeed, a straitjacket could not have stopped me, although I knew I would have to be very careful, which presented some difficulty. Having spent the better part of the past month closeted in my lodgings, bitter over my mother's failure to help me in my time of need, having been, in other words, idle and sulking, I now found myself woefully unprepared for action. There were a dozen items I required but did not have. Wrapping a nondescript shawl around my head and shoulders, I sallied forth to acquire them. Mrs. Tupper would be pleased. I was going for a walk. I did walk all the way, because my emotions felt as tangled as the labyrinthine passages of the slums, my thoughts as crowded and confused as the smutty tenements with their peaked garrets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.